from God on our Bible study. And so if you don't mind, bow with me again, please. Father, we are so thankful again. What a privilege to be here. And now, Father, especially once again, we are calling upon you to bless us as we open your word together, as we contemplate these things that you have brought to us. Father, we pray that as we study, you'll find in us hearts that long to know your will and hearts that long to obey your will. And so it's in the name of Jesus we would ask you to bless us in these few minutes of study together, and we say amen. All right, let's just jump right into it and start talking about becoming a person of God. Now, when we talk about becoming a person of God, I'm not going to talk to you about how to become a Christian. I'm going to be talking to you about how to become the Christian God wants you to be. It's not that we're going to ignore how to become a Christian, but we're going to focus tonight on when you become a Christian, that you understand that God wants you to become a man or a woman of God, fully grown, fully mature. And I can't think of a better place in Scripture to talk about the concept of maturing as a Christian than in 2 Peter. And what we're going to do is, we're going to do seemingly, at least for me, and people who know me well, they would think that this is absolutely crazy that I can cover an entire book in about 30 minutes. But we're going to do that. We're going to cover 2 Peter. You're going to get a basic gist of Peter, 2 Peter, and I think that you're going to, if you open your heart to it, then God's going to give you some very important instruction, and hopefully not only instruction but inspiration into reaching your fullest potential as one of His people. 2 Peter, with that said now, Peter approaches it in what I consider to be a rather unique way. Now, what I mean by that is, if I were sitting down and I were writing what he was writing, I probably would have approached it a little bit different. Now, I'm not going to question him since he was under the supervision of the Spirit of God, and so God was really the ultimate author. And so I'm not saying, you know, Peter, you really didn't do a great job in how you approached it. It's just really kind of a unique perspective, and what I mean, or at least a unique model, and here's what I mean by that. Normally, when you're writing about a problem and a solution, you normally talk about the problem first, and then you talk about the solution. That's typically how we approach things. But Peter doesn't deal with that, or he doesn't approach it that way. He starts solution first, and then he gets into the problem. And so so what we're going to do when we talk about 2 Peter and understand what 2 Peter really is all about, we're going to jump over chapter 1 and we're going to start in chapter 2 where he's talking about the problem that the people to whom he is writing that they're facing, that they're having to deal with. And then we're going to go back to chapter 1 and we're going to get the solution to the problem. And it's really there in chapter 1 and the solution to the problem that we're going to get the emphasis on becoming the person reaching our fullest potential as a child of God. So with that in mind, let's look at chapter 2 of 2 Peter and let's talk about the problem. Here it is, first of all, in a nutshell. Two words, false teaching. Now, false teaching has always been a problem that God's people have had to deal with. It always has been. And it always will be. Until Jesus Christ comes again, there are always going to be people who are going to come in the name of Jesus Christ. They're going to carry a well-worn New Testament. They're going to sometimes speak about Jesus the way he ought to be spoken of. But the reality is they're sometimes going to be bringing things that aren't healthy. They're going to be bringing things that aren't true. They are going to sometimes be peddling error. And Peter's going to mention that, in fact, a little bit later when he goes in chapter 3 and he says down in verse 16, it's one of the more familiar verses in 2 Peter. He talks about the things that Paul has written to them. And he says in verse 16, as also in all his letters, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to understand, which the untaught and unstable distort, as they do the rest of Scriptures to their own destruction. And so, see, he's talking about some people who have the Scripture, they use the Scripture, they read the Scripture, they teach the Scripture, But they're twisting the scripture and they're distorting the scripture. And the actual word that he uses for twisting is actually torturing. And they torture the scripture. And so Peter's dealing with something that has always been a problem that God's people has always had to deal with, false teaching. Now what we find in chapter 2 is we're going to find a little bit about the nature of the particular false teaching that his readers are facing. We're going to get a little bit of insight into the motive behind it. We're going to get a little bit of insight into the methods that they use and those that are most vulnerable. But first of all, let's take a look at the real problem that they're facing. Look down at verse 10. We're going to catch Peter in mid-sentence here, but he speaks of the false teachers, and he says that especially those who indulge the flesh in its corruption, corrupt desires, and despise authority. Now, what I want you to see, and this is going to help us to understand exactly the nature of the false teaching that Peter's having to deal with here, it's in those last two words in the New American Standard, despise authority. Now, if you'll go over to verse 19 now, and Peter says about these false teachers, they promise freedom, promising them freedom while they themselves are slaves to corruption. They despise authority and they promise freedom. I've circled despise authority there in verse 10. I've circled promising freedom in verse 19 and I've hooked them together. The nature then of the false teaching that Peter is dealing with is a perversion of the idea of Christian freedom. These false teachers come along and they despise authority. In other words, they don't like being told what to do. They really want to do things their way. Anything that they do, even in the name of Jesus Christ, they want to do it their way. The idea of having authority over them, the idea that they're not in charge is something that they just, they have an allergic reaction to that idea that someone else is in charge and that they don't get to set their own trajectory about everything. They despise authority. They want freedom, verse 19, and they come along promising freedom. You can almost hear them as they're standing before God's people and saying things like this. Listen, you're free in Jesus Christ. And isn't that true? We are free in Jesus Christ. We are. Scripture teaches that we're free in Christ. And then they come along and they would say something like this. You need to appreciate freedom in Christ. Folks, listen, think about it. Think about it. What does that mean to be free in Christ? Freedom means you're free. Freedom means no constraints. Freedom means no boundaries, no fences, no walls. Three cheers for Christian freedom. In Jesus Christ, you're free now. Embrace that freedom. Cherish that freedom. Quit worrying about messing this up or messing that up or not doing something that you're supposed to do. You're free in Jesus Christ. You know, people have always been taken Christian concepts like freedom and grace and love. And they've always taken amazing ideas like that and they've twisted them. And that's what's going on here. They're twisting a great idea and perverting it to make it say something that it doesn't really say. You know, I remember when we were in college, John, I don't know if you remember this guy or not. Sometimes we'd tune into it. It was in Nashville and we'd tune into it. Yeah, I remember when my kids went to Freed back in 2010, my daughter started. 2009, that's right. Man, I'm telling you, time gets away. So the fall of 2009, and I told her, she was taking her TV, and I said, well, we need, listen, this is so embarrassing to say this. I said, yeah, we need to probably go and get you an antenna. Because when I was in college, first of all, we had about, a couple of the networks and a bad preaching channel, and that was it. And the only way that you could get them was like, you know, with rabbit ears, and sometimes you had to hang then clothes hangers on the rabbit ears, and that's just how it was. And, you know, I didn't really think about it. I thought, you know, 20-some years later, it's still like that. I didn't know they have cable now in the dorms. And she's like, Dad, we got cable. And so, well, we didn't have cable. We didn't have the luxury of cable. And so, like I said, we had a couple of networks and a bad preaching channel. And so you didn't have a lot of variety. Well, there was this one guy that, this preacher, this local preacher, and his name was Dr. Scott. I don't know. He was this guy, and he would preach, and he would sit there in a chair as he preached, and he had a glass of wine in one hand, and he had a cigar in the other. And at first, I thought it was a satire, that he was kind of making a mockery of televangelists who were really kind of preaching and then leading corrupt, immoral lives, and it was kind of a satire. But then when you listened to him very long, you knew it wasn't a satire. He just believed in something called antinomianism. Well, what in the world is antinomianism? Well, the word anti means against. And nomianism comes from a Greek word nomos, which means the law. Deuteronomy comes from the second nomos, the second law, giving of the law. Against law. What he was preaching is what the folks in 2 Peter, Peter's having to deal with. Peter's dealing with antinomianism. There is no law. You're free. You're free to do whatever you want. And so that's the idea that Peter's having to deal with. These Christians are being exposed to this warped, perverted view of Christian freedom. Now, I want you to notice in terms of the methodology, look down at verse 18. How were they able to really take this false teaching about freedom, and how were they able to sell it to God's people? Well, verse 18 says, "For speaking out arrogant words of vanity." I like some translations say, "great swelling words of vanity." That really captures it. Speaking great swelling words of vanity. In other words, words that sound so right, but vanity. They're really empty and they're hollow. They were really master orators. They could speak. They knew how to put words together. They could string thoughts together. They made them sound so right, so holy, so biblical, so scriptural. It sounded so full of truth, and yet it was so empty. They were just very, very persuasive. Well, things haven't changed. Listen, there's nothing wrong with being a persuasive speaker. The Lord needs people who are gifted in their ability to communicate. There's nothing wrong with that. But you have to understand that just because somebody's persuasive, that doesn't mean you just kind of kick your brain out of gear and just eat everything that they say. Things have to be evaluated. But they came along and they were good at selling this perverted view of Christian freedom. So you've got kind of that methodology. They're coming along. They were very appealing. They knew what to say. They knew how to say it. And the people were becoming very vulnerable to this twisted teaching. Now, let's take a look real quick at who's most vulnerable. When you talk about being victimized by false teaching, this hasn't changed either in terms of who's most vulnerable. Look down, if you will, about verse 14. Speaking about the false teachers, he says, "having eyes full of adultery that never cease from sin, enticing unstable souls, having a heart trained in greed, accursed children." It's those two words, unstable souls. They're enticing unstable souls. If you look down at verse 18, "for speaking out arrogant words of vanity, they entice by fleshly desires, by sensuality, those who barely escape from the ones who live in error." Unstable souls. Those who barely escape the ones who are living in error. Those who are most vulnerable to false teaching are the weakest spiritually in the church. Weakness makes one vulnerable. Unstable souls. Those who are just escaping error. They just don't have the capacity yet to discern truth and error. They're not able to detect some of the subtleties of theology and scripture and doctrine. They're growing, and they haven't grown to that point yet, or maybe they haven't pursued growth to that point, but they're vulnerable. You know, it's that way in everything. The weak, the infirmed, those are always the most vulnerable in nature. You know, we've all watched National Geographic, and we've all watched Discovery, and you know, those shows, and we've all seen the lion or the leopard or something, the tiger crouching in the bush, and we know when they're showing one of those what they're going to show next. They're going to show a young gazelle or a weak old water buffalo. Because when these packs of predators go after something, they don't go after the strongest. They go after the weakest. The weak or vulnerable. Well, it's the same thing in a spiritual dynamic. And that's what's going on. So that's the problem that Peter's dealing with. He's coming to the church. He's writing to them. And he says, now listen, church. There are people among you, and they are taking the Word of God. They're taking Scripture, and they are twisting it. They are holding up Scripture. They're claiming to respect Scripture. They're speaking from Scripture. They're quoting from Scripture. They're taking scriptural ideas like freedom, and they're distorting them. They're twisting them, and they are saying what the Holy Spirit of God never said. And those of you who are unstable and weak and immature, you're the most vulnerable to these teachers. I want you to grow. That's what Peter says. If you're going to be able to resist this, there is one solution and one solution only, and that is you've got to grow up. You've got to mature. And so that's what Peter's going to talk about in chapter 1. So let's go to chapter 1 now, and let's talk about what it means and how we can grow as a Christian, how we can strengthen ourselves, how we can really build a barrier up that's going to help us to resist all of the spiritual predators that are around us. Chapter 1. Now, we're going to look at it. If you look down about verse 5, we're going to really kind of zero in on verses 5 through 7. He's going to mention what some call the seven virtues of 2 Peter chapter 1. I like to tell people this. There really aren't too many formulas for life. I'm not a big formula guy. In other words, life just doesn't really typically work that way, where, you know, whether it's, you know, fill in the blank, whether it's job success or marriage or child rearing or whatever. There really is no formula that if you get all the numbers right, you're guaranteed a particular solution. Life doesn't work that way in our broken world. And so there aren't a lot of formulas. There are real important principles that apply to all areas of life, and you can find a lot of them in the book of Proverbs, that God gives us principles for life that really are going to help us thrive and excel in life. But they're Proverbs. They're not ironclad guarantees. That's important to understand. And so, after I say, you know, there aren't really a lot of formulas in life, this is about as close to a formula for spiritual growth and development as I think there is anywhere in Scripture. Now, before we start looking at these seven items, I want you to notice something, though. I want you to look at verse 5. Now, for this very reason also, applying all diligence is what the New American Standard says. Applying all diligence. And it's that word diligence that I want to emphasize. And if you go down to verse 10, therefore, brethren, be all the more diligent. I've circled diligent up there in verse 5. I've circled diligent in verse 10. I've drawn a line connecting those. And then on the margin of my Bible, I put chapter 3 and verse 14, because Peter says, therefore, beloved, since you look for these things, be diligent to be found in Him, to be spotless and at peace when He comes. Diligent. Now, I want to emphasize that because there's a very important thing to keep in mind. When we talk about growing into the person of God, growing into a man of God, growing into a woman of God, you need to understand that word, diligent, applying diligence. Now, what that means is simply this. It's not just going to happen automatically. You're not just going to automatically grow up into a strong person of God. It's going to take diligence. You're not just going to accidentally stumble into being a strong, mature Christian. You're not just going to pray and ask God to help make you a mature Christian and then just sit back and the Holy Spirit's going to come and just ooze all over you and suddenly you're going to be this mature, strong child of God. It doesn't work that way. You are going to have to be diligent. It doesn't happen by accident. I'm a Dave Ramsey disciple in terms of personal finance, and I'm sure some of you probably are familiar with Dave Ramsey, and he's popular nationwide, and I've brought Financial Peace University to the different churches that I've been a part of, and to help people with personal finance and those kind of things. And I remember one thing Dave said, and I've heard him say it many times on radio through the years, is listen, whenever you're in debt and you're covered up in debt and you want to get out of debt, he would say, listen, you're not just going to accidentally wander out of debt. You're not just going to accidentally wake up one day because you want to be out of debt and you're going to be out of debt. It doesn't work that way. I've heard people call in and say, listen, I'm tired of this debt and I want to get out of debt. What do I need to do? And he'll talk with them for a little bit. And I've actually heard him say to some people, oh, but you're not going to do it. And they kind of get a little peeved at him and go, well, what do you mean? He goes, well, I can just tell by talking. What I'm telling you and your response to me, I can tell you're not going to do it. Because, see, you're sick and tired of being in debt, but you'll never get out of debt when you're sick and tired of it. You won't get out of debt until you're sick and tired of being sick and tired of it. He said, and you're not there yet. It's not going to just happen. You're not going to excel in personal finance accidentally. Same principle spiritually. It's just not going to happen accidentally. You got to do it on purpose. You got to be willing to put the work in. And that's why Peter uses that word there in verse 10 and in verse 19 and in chapter 3 and verse 14. Diligent, diligent, diligent. It's the way that God designed it to be, to grow into the person that He wants you to be, strong and mature. You've got to be diligent. Now, with that in mind, let's look at something else right here before we look at these seven ones. I want you to look at verse 8 now. These particular qualities, now notice what he says here. If these qualities, these seven qualities that we're about to look at, if these qualities are yours and are increasing, listen, if you focus on bringing these seven qualities into your life, if you become really conscious of them and developing them, they are yours and increasing. You've got to bring them in and you've got to work at increasing and developing these qualities. If they are yours and increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful. Listen, you want to be useful for God? See there? You want to be useful for God. You want to be fruitful for God. You want to have purpose. You want to have meaning. These qualities. You've got to recognize the importance of these qualities. You've got to consciously say, I'm going to develop these qualities in my life. If these qualities are yours and they are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. But now look at verse 9. For he who lacks these qualities is blind or short-sighted. Now if you don't have them, if you are not on purpose trying to develop these qualities in your life, it's the same as the image he uses, is blind or short-sighted. Listen, some of you can really appreciate this. And if you're like me, you can really appreciate it. My eyes are absolutely horrible. Now, they correct to 20/20, so I'm good. But they have always been awful. And my glasses are, if you look at these and you look at them from the side, they are thick. And they are featherweight lenses. If they were like the normal lenses, they'd be like a half an inch thick. They're just, I'm just blind. When my wife and I are standing at our sinks in the bathroom, a lot of times, you know, I'll take my glasses off and I better be careful about setting them down. I might not find them because she's not here. I'll set them down and I'll start feeling for them. I go, sweetheart, where are my glasses are? And she'll say, they're over there by your right hand. I go, oh, okay, thanks. They are that bad. I could not function. I could not drive. I couldn't go out. I'm helpless. I can't see threats without my glasses. I am completely helpless and vulnerable in a lot of situations. And so I can really appreciate what he's saying here. And so he says, listen, you're going to be spiritually that way. If these qualities, if you're not conscious of them, you're not purposely trying to develop them into your life, then it is spiritual blindness. You are going to be so vulnerable and you're going to be so threatened. Now, I wanted to emphasize that in verse 8 and 9 to help you understand and appreciate how important these things are that he's telling us. Now, with that in mind, let's take a look real quick at these seven ones. This formula, if you will, for becoming the man of God or the woman of God that he wants you to be. Reaching your fullest spiritual potential in Jesus Christ. Okay, take a look at it. Verse 5. Now, for this very reason, applying all diligence in your faith. See, that's where it begins. You're a Christian. He's talking to Christians here. In your faith. See, that's the beginning. That's not the end. You're a Christian. In your faith, he says, supply moral excellence. Some translations say supply virtue. Now, what I want you to notice is this, and I don't want us to help you understand all of these characteristics, but I want you to also see how they're not randomly placed there. There's a purpose here. There's an order. The Holy Spirit, as he's supervising Peter writing this, you're going to see the logical order that he puts these in. So he says, okay, in your faith, the first thing that you do, you're conscious about becoming a morally excellent person. Do you think about that? Do you consciously think about that? You should. God calls us to moral excellence. He calls us, as he would say in 1 Peter, he calls us to be holy as he is holy. God is moral and ethical perfection, and God wants us to reflect his character in our lives. Now, we're not going to be moral and ethical perfection, but he does expect us to be morally and ethically excellent. And that's what this is all about. And so he says, basically, he's saying this, look, every single day, when you get up and throughout the day, you need to think about God's call that you be a morally excellent person. You're going to let your behavior be shaped by the character and the will of God. Now, one of the reasons, and you can see how all of this fits together in the greater context, these false teachers are coming along and saying, listen, you're free in Christ. God has given you the freedom in Jesus Christ. Jesus has paid for your sins. And so, you know, in reality, what you do as a child of God, that's not important. What matters is that you are a child of God. Peter comes along and says, no, that's not true at all. You know, you actually hear that today. There's this extreme form that's in the larger religious community. It is an extreme form called once saved, always saved. Now, people have different views of once saved, always saved. There are some people who have a view of once saved, always saved that says this. If you're a Christian, then you're going to be morally excellent and you're not going to abandon that lifestyle, and so you'll persist and always be that way. But that's not what we're talking about. There's another view, an extreme view, that says once you become a Christian, then really, you know, you shouldn't live immoral, but even if you do, it really doesn't matter. Because once that moment came, when you raised your hand, when you filled out that card, when you said that prayer, whatever it is, then you became a child of God. Nobody can ever take that from you, no matter what you do. That teaching is out there. Well, Peter says, no, that's not true. Foundational to Christian living is moral excellence. You're to look like God's character. You are to strive to emulate and to reflect him morally and ethically. That's where it begins. And so he tells them, okay, first of all, to your faith, you add this aspiration, this passion. Your goal is to be a morally excellent person. Well, that leads us to this question. What is morally excellent? What does that mean? I mean, if you ask the world what's morally excellent, you're going to get a lot of different answers. Increasingly, the world disagrees very much with what the Bible says about moral excellence and what is moral. So what is it? Well, look at the next, and remember what I said about these logically fitting together. And in your moral excellence, knowledge. See, you can't be morally excellent unless you know what is morally excellent. You can't reflect the character of God and the will of God unless you know what the will of God is. So you've got to add knowledge to your life. You've got to be growing in your knowledge. Well, where in the world does that come from? Hint, hint. It comes from here. It's the only place. All Scripture is God-breathed, Paul's going to say in 2 Timothy. All Scripture is God-breathed. And all Scripture is profitable for everything to make us, as God's people, complete, spiritually mature. It's for teaching. It's for instructing. It's for correcting. It's for rebuking. It's for training us in righteousness. This is how we know God's will. This is how we know God's character. Now again, if you're listening to the world and you're listening to the voices of culture, they're going to tell you some very different things about moral excellence. Some things they're going to say is absolutely right. Some things. And a lot of things they're going to say is absolutely wrong. This is the only source of knowledge. And so you've got to give yourself to the Word of God. I'm telling you, you've got to spend time with the Word of God. Not only on a personal level, but on times like this. And I really appreciate the elders, and they put together times like this, not only regular Bible study times and regular worship periods, but special events like this that give you that opportunity to come and just sit under the teaching of the Word of God and grow in your understanding, grow in your knowledge. You've got to aspire to it. You know, I tell kids when they go off to college or whatever, my exhortations to them are real pretty simple, and one of them is this. One of them is, listen, don't ever on purpose miss a gathering of God's people. Don't ever do that. And when I say on purpose, I understand that there's going to be times when, you know, you may be sick and not able to. You may grow up and you may have a job like my wife where every third Sunday she doesn't have any choice. You might be a cop, you might be a nurse like her and things like that. That's not missing on purpose. Don't miss on purpose, because you need to grow in your knowledge. And this is where a lot of that knowledge is gained, places like that. So you've got to really make this conscious commitment. I'm going to grow in my knowledge. This isn't just going to happen. You know, I had a friend in back at Lipscomb. We even went to high school together. His name's Mike Self. And Mike's a great, great guy. And he's a deacon in the Lord's Church today in Franklin. But I remember, and Mike will tell you, and he was not a very motivated student at all. And I remember one time he had a big test. And I walked in the room one time, and he has the book laying on his head. And I go, dude, what are you doing? And he said, it's osmosis. He said, I'm studying by osmosis. I'm just putting it on my head, in other words, and it's going to soak into my brain. And he was hoping so, so desperately. Well, osmosis didn't work, and he got a BMI degree, a barely made it degree, but he's done very well. He's done very well now, but the osmosis didn't work. Listen, a lot of people think that if this is sitting on your coffee table or your nightstand or on a shelf at home, that something's going to happen, and this stuff is just going to kind of magically leap into you. No, it doesn't do that. You got to purposely aspire for knowledge. So, okay. You got to consciously think about, I'm going to be morally excellent. I'm going to grow in my knowledge, so I'll know what morally excellent, what God's will for me is. So I'll know how to then, see, that helps you resist these false teachers who come along and say, oh, let me tell you this. No. That gaining in knowledge helps you deal with that. Now let's look at the next one. And he says, and in your knowledge, verse 6, self-control. Now, again, see how they're building on each other and they all relate to each other and they're logically placed. You want to be morally excellent. You give yourself to knowing the Word of God so that you'll know what God's will is for your life. That doesn't matter at all if you can't practice self-control. You can know what's right, but if you can't practice any self-control, it doesn't matter. Self-control is one of the fundamental parts, one of the fundamental principles of Christianity. Now listen, I want to tell you, you're not going to be perfect in self-control. Let me tell you why. Because when you came out of the baptistry, you came out redeemed. But you also came out still dragging behind this unredeemed body with you. And you're going to always be dragging it around. And that's why you can read places like Romans chapter 7 where Paul is speaking in such frustration. And he's just so frustrated with his own struggles with the flesh. And I love the fact that that's in there because it's so encouraging to me that Paul is so frustrated at his periodic failures. And he's so grateful at the end of that chapter that eventually Jesus Christ is going to deliver him from these struggles. So when we talk about self-control, I don't want you to be overwhelmed by the fact that you don't perfectly practice self-control. Nobody's perfect. But one thing is for sure, you can grow in self-control. And you can bring in other people, friends, close friends, and a spouse, and kind of covenant with each other to help hold each other accountable, and you can choose who you hang around with, and all of these things will help you develop it. Because listen, you can know what's right, but if you can't practice self-control, if you can't say no to a temptation, knowing what's right, it doesn't really matter at the end. Now let's look at the next one real quick. And to your self-control, look what he says, verse 6. Perseverance. Ah, see that again. Watch it all logically fall together. You want to be morally excellent. You want to be what God calls you to be. You give yourself to the study of God's Word. You listen to Him speak through His Word so that you can know what His will is for your life. You're practicing self-control. But listen, Christianity is a marathon. It's not a sprint. You are victorious today. Praise God for that. Thank God for that. But listen, you've got to persevere in that. It's not one day of self-control. It's not one day of moral excellence. It's tomorrow morally excellent. And it's the next day morally excellent. And it's 5 years from now being what God calls you to be. It is every day conscious of the fact that God wants you to be salt and light. He wants you to be conspicuously different than your surroundings. He wants you to reflect His character and the character of Jesus Christ. And that takes perseverance. I really like the word perseverance here, by the way. It's a word, it's a compound word that Peter uses in the Greek language. The prefix of it is hupo, and we get the word, it means under. We get the word like hypodermic needle, an under the skin needle, hupo. And then the verb that's attached to is the verb for to remain, mone, to remain. It literally means to remain under. And it was often used in a context, a setting, a military setting, to mean you stay at your post. You know, we've all seen enough war movies. Some of you may have experienced this, where you're in a dire situation and you are called upon to stay at your post and hold that position even against overwhelming odds. You have to hold that position. That's the word that's used in that context and setting. That's what we have to do as a Christian. We have to hold. We have to hold on. We have to persevere. It's going to be tough sometimes to be morally excellent. It's going to be tough sometimes to say no to temptations. It's going to be tough sometimes to go in a completely different direction than the people around us. It's going to be really, really hard, but God expects that of us. Remain under. Remain at our post. Now look, very quickly, the next thing that he says, into verse 6 here. And to your perseverance, godliness. The idea of godliness here is a deep respect for the things of God. This is God first. It's that kind of God first mentality. That what's going to help us persevere and be what God wants us to be is we just absolutely appreciate the reality that He is the Lord of our lives. That He is in control. When He says go right, we go right. When He says go left, we go left. When He says do this, we do this. When He says don't do this, we stop doing it. It is that deep respect for His sovereignty, His kingship, and His rule. He is in charge. That's the idea of godliness. We have surrendered to Him. We're going to rise every day with the realization that we surrendered to Him and that He's guiding everything. Then if you go on and you look at verse 7, in your godliness, I want to look at brotherly kindness and brotherly kindness love, those two things at the end. I wish we could say more. We could spend a whole lesson on all of these virtues. Maybe Scott's done that here. Several have. Preachers have done it. And you can develop these things and look real close. We don't have time to do that. I wish we did. But brotherly kindness and love, both of those things speak to the importance of the connection with the body of Christ and our relationship with the body of Christ. Listen, don't ever forget, Christianity is not just a personal individual experience. Now, there is a personal individual dimension to it, absolutely. Nobody else can be saved for you. Absolutely, there is a personal dimension to Christianity. But there is also a corporate dimension. When God saved you, He put you in a body. He gave you a spiritual family. And it's really important for you to be connected to that spiritual family for your well-being, for your development, for your safety. There's always been safety in numbers, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. There's always safety in numbers. So brotherly kindness and love speaks to that. It speaks of that sensitivity to the interest of others, the well-being of others, the need to encourage others and to be encouraged by others. Man, this is a long, sometimes brutal fight spiritually. We are in a battle, not against flesh and blood, but we are in a real battle for something far more valuable than real estate, our very souls for eternity. We need help and we need encouragement. We need to be lifted up. All of those things are found in that idea, those two ideas of brotherly kindness and love. It goes back to that thing about, again, being connected with a body. Finding yourself, your place in the body to serve and to function. God wants you to grow. There are threats all around us. There will always be threats. And one of the ways that you mitigate against those threats is to grow. God wants you to grow. You have a spiritual potential that He wants you to reach. It's not going to happen accidentally. It's going to take you real consciously, purposely, intentionally pursuing it. You got to give diligence. These qualities here really give you that course. It gives you that trajectory. It gives you that roadmap, as you will. So I hope you this year, as you start out this new year, that you're all about not only your own personal growth into the person of God, maturing as a person of God, but helping others mature as well. Let's pray. Father, we are so thankful that we can come to You now and we can ask a blessing, that we ask You to bless this study. I pray, Father, that our hearts have been open to Your teaching and Your Word. Father, we do want to grow. We want to become men of Yours. We want to become women of Yours. And Father, we need Your help. And we know that You've given us instruction. We know that You've given us Your Spirit. And we just pray, Father, that we'll all have a renewed determination to pursue maturity and to pursue our spiritual potential. Lord, thank You for Your patience. On those times when we fail and our self-control just falls apart, please, Father, help us to never be overwhelmed with despair, but to get up and to find You there, always ready to forgive and to empower. And Father, we're so thankful for that patience and mercy and grace that You give. And Father, help us to extend that to others who are struggling. And thank You, Father, for others who encourage us in our struggles. But Father, I pray that we'll all aspire to growth. Help us to recognize threats. Help us to recognize the reality that Satan is truly a roaring lion, that he wants to devour us, that he wants us to separate, he wants to separate us from you for all eternity. Father, help us to be committed to you and to your church and to your word, so that ultimately, Father, when this very brief life is over, we can stand before you and we can spend eternity in your presence. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ, who made it all possible through dying for our sins, that we offer this prayer and we say amen. Well, as I said at the beginning, this isn't about how to become a Christian. It's about how to grow as a Christian. But we want to give you the opportunity to become a Christian. If you have, you can't grow as a Christian until you become a Christian first. And you become a Christian, it's pretty simple. Acts chapter 2, the same message that was preached on that very first time that forgiveness of sins in Jesus Christ was presented, that same message is as relevant today and as applicable today as it was 20 centuries ago. And it's this: if you believe that Jesus Christ is the crucified and resurrected Lord, then repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins. If you've not done that, we want to encourage you to do that. We'd love to share with you in that new birth, that renewal tonight. If you've done that but you've wandered away and you need to come back to the Lord, we encourage that. If you need to do it in a public way, please do it. We'd love to pray with you and for you. And so if you have a spiritual need to take care of, please do it right now while together we stand and while we sing.
This wonderful lesson has been tonight. Thank you, Brother Dan, for that wonderful, wonderful message. And it just fits so much in the idea that we have for our All Members Weekend, is that we would stop and look at the Word of God and really, in an impactful way, search the Scriptures to see the things that will help us be the people of God that He wants us to be this year. And It's just been a tremendous weekend, and I hope those who have tuned in online have had the opportunity to hear, and we'd invite you to even go back. If you weren't here last night, you can go back online and see the lesson from last night. Do that. Hope you can be with us tomorrow morning for our day of worship. We're going to have our classes here in the auditorium at 9 a.m., and then we'll have our regular worship service at 10. We'd invite you all to stay and have a meal with us. And this is a potluck meal, so you church members, you know to bring plenty of food and stay. Bring enough for your family and for others as well. And we should have a great time visiting together. We're excited about introducing some new things, some tools that will help you in moving the needle more in your daily walk toward Christ. And we'll let you know about some of that in the morning as well. tomorrow afternoon, in lieu of the 6 o'clock hour, we'll have a 1 o'clock service here again in the auditorium. So we've got a big day. So we wish you Godspeed and be careful as you head home. Get plenty of rest tonight and come back and be with us once again. We'll sing another song. Brother Nolan, have him come and lead us in a prayer. Thank you.
Our closing song will be number 153, Footprints of Jesus. We'll sing the first three verses, then we'll be dismissed with a word of prayer.
Sweetly, Lord, have we heard thee calling, come, follow me.
Thank you so much for tonight, for this opportunity to be able to come together on a Saturday evening when we're normally not together, to be able to study your word, be able to listen to a message delivered to us, and Lord, help us to take what we've learned tonight and help it to apply it to our lives, go forth as stronger Christians than we were when we entered these doors. Lord, please be with us as we're going home this evening. Grant us safety, and also grant us safety to be able to come back in the morning, to be able to continue in this all-members weekend, and just to continue to grow and to really take full advantage of this weekend that's been laid out by the elders. Lord, I ask that you please help us to really truly be men and women of God, to be like you in our speech, in our behavior, and in our attitudes. And as people of God, I ask you to help us be people of prayer, to pray for our nation, especially right now as we're going through tough times, but that you'll help us to pray during this election season. Pray to help us to be conscientious in who we vote for, to help lead our nation in the correct direction, and to pray for our current leaders. Help our nation to be able to glorify you in what we do. Thank you so much for sending your son to die for us, for our sins, and it's for that great sacrifice, and for that really is the reason why we're here tonight. All this is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.